allowed to leave the country. He is in trouble if he left. So he is one of the greatest chemists in Tehran. And so I read a review on how oxygen is made. It's in a book published in India, and I have that also. So, all right, now let's go on. So, light was absorbed, electron went up within femtoseconds, and the blue light, it came down very quickly within maybe a few femtoseconds, and then it stayed there for 100 seconds. So, but after it, molecule absorbed the light, it had to, since you have photosynthetic unit, it had to go to the other molecule, the reaction center sitting over there, the gentleman over there. So basically, it has to travel. It has to move. So let us look at that. Professor Robert Clegg, professor of physics at Urbana, Illinois, a very good friend. I published reviews with him on this whole idea of the chemistry. Now I'm publishing virtual, another physics professor. So Professor Clegg and I worked and talked to each other. Very often over coffee and tea, trying to understand. So he said, well, he went to Germany and he saw all these things. He said, that reminded me of photosynthesis. Chlorophyll molecules everywhere. So he said, a photon came in and it was absorbed, and so he looked at the photon, then it all around until it reaches the reaction. So the movie, it should be in the PDF, but it may be the PC versus Mac, why it's not working, but it normally works. All right, so then it reaches, and that's where the reaction. Now, how does it move? Who are the pioneers? And what did they say? What is the principle? What's the chemistry? What's the physics behind the motions? So here's the word exciton. And then what's the photon is the light. Exciton is called the excited electron. It's the electron is really not excited, but it has more energy than it's the molecule. So the word exciton was coined. So it's an exciton transfer, or we can say, Forster would say, excitation energy transfer. That is a more appropriate word because it is really the excitation energy that is being transferred. All right, so who? Consider Forster, German chemist. Now he is standing next to Bob Knox, professor of now doesn't work in photosynthesis. He's now doing planet calculus. So what's the theory? So they did many experiments in a simple system, and they said, well, if you are far away, it's very hard for me to transfer my excitation energy to you. You're very far. She is very near, and it's very near. I can move, and then I can come here, and then be transferred here, and here. So what is the actual distance law? So he discovered that it depends on 1 over r to the 6th, but r is the distance between the donor molecule, and if you are down the donor and she is acceptor, then the distance between the two will be energy transfer, will be governed by the distance. That's one of the important things that we did. And it says it also depends on the, what we call a kappa. What is kappa? Orientation factor. Now, I'm like this. Am I not like that? Okay, maybe excitation energy transfer. comes like that, she's like that. Because the overlap of energy level depends on the orientation. He says it depends on what's called the kappa square, or kappa is it's a lot of equations. I may spare you from, but they're nice. I have my lectures, of 12 lectures I gave in 1980. It's my website. You can download the file, and it has the equations. And then the next is the overlapping. Now this.
So when we talk about orientation
factor
with respect to what?
To each other. it is a chemistry term, not the orientation when you go to a class. It's a holiday, orienting yourself with it. No, the chemistry term, which means the dipole is here and your dipole is here. So means plus charge, negative charge. So it is that defines orientation, and it has an equation which I'm sparing you from. Okay? So it's a very specific thing. It is not an orientation going to.
Does this obey the law of Arrhenius' law?
Send me that question too. Because you have very good questions. Arrhenius' law is for something else, this is for something else. Everything has to follow the Arrhenius law. So just like your other question, you cannot be excluding the Pauli exclusion. Here also, you cannot be excluding the Arrhenius law. So nothing, when something is known, it is cannot disobey. But your good question, because you are now thinking, does it or does it not? Can you send me an email again? Second email, or the same email? And because the answer is at least 20 minutes. Yeah.
I better.
Yes. Where do we use this?
What do you mean, where do you use? I'm trying to say, what is the efficiency of energy transfer from here to here? So, if we want to calculate the energy transfer, we don't know the distance. It is an equation of the efficiency of energy transfer. Is all these factors are crucial. But this is the second, there's a third factor. It is.
Yeah. There is some formula.
Yes, this is the first formula I'm talking about. And the formula, I'll give you the formula. It is in the papers. Okay, and you send me an email, I'll send you the formula. Yeah. But the point is that if I bring the formula also right now, then I cannot bring the concept. So important thing for me is to bring the concept so that you understand the concept, that you have an orientation, and therefore the overlap is not good, and therefore energy transfer is less. If the orientation is the same, energy transfer is more. The next thing is the overlap integral. What does it mean? So, I don't have a question. All right, let me just try to move my hand. So, I am in molecule excited here. So I have an absorption spectrum. Absorption is directly proportional to the energy. So you have an absorption band, it's got a lambda on this. And then when I fluoresce from, I lose energy, the internal conversion, so lose it from here, which means the arrow is shorter, which means the fluorescence is always shifted to the right, so the stops. I didn't put that right. So now, with the other, she has to be absorbed, get transferred. If her energy level is lower than mine, and then she has a fluorescence farther, more higher gradient. So there is the overlap integral is called the overlap of this energy level and the overlap of the next molecule process. So there is a relationship between the energy transfer and the overlap. If she had energy level here, there will be very little overlap and there will be no transfer. So the overlap integral means that the energy levels overlap with each other enough to allow. Yeah? Somebody else? I heard. Okay. Is that okay? So these are the three factors, and I'll give the formula in the next lecture, but also
I can tell you by email or something. Yeah. All
right. So next, we have to give you a feeling for the energy structure and the molecule. The feeling comes from knowing the protein never static. Proteins are dynamic. They are as if breathing. They are breathing. And this picture shows the reaction center of molecules sitting in the protein. And therefore, nothing is totally static and everything is changing to the extent that you can change the entire formula to a certain degree if these motions add to the energy or take it away. So this is a picture to make you understand and feel that you're dealing with a living dynamic system. Even though proteins in the system are not living, but it is dynamic. All right, so now here is a picture to give you this feeling that you have many, many energy levels of many, many molecules together. Are they the same? They're not the same. Some are higher. This is the Frankfurter diagram. Some are higher, some are lower. So when a photon and exciton comes in, it's like a molecule with many surfaces. What happens? It just feels all the molecules because it doesn't know where to go because it's going. Basically, go to the bottom. This slide was made by Professor Ring from London, Professor Chidi, and the University of. I want to make sure that they can see what you're doing. I show this slide. And so that this is the goal where. Now, all these personal theory, which is based on first chemical reaction, imagine that it is a one-way transfer. It's a slow transfer, one way, going from the higher energy to the lower. Recently, Graham Fleming, a professor of chemistry at University of California, but not so recent. I don't know what's going on. I need to show the slide as well. Did I do something with the pilot slide? Maybe I hit something there. Yeah. So, then the physicist came and with the theory that, listen, there's something else. And that is the excitation energy transfer need not go this direction down here like this. But you have an exciton that actually belongs to the whole molecule. And you have all essentially the same energy level. So the exciton doesn't know where to go. It belongs to all the molecules. They are so exciton belongs, so it's called, when it is transferred, it's called coherent excitation instead of incoherent. So this is Graham Fleming. So what he said, the quantum coherence, the first papers were published in Nature 2005, 2007, and continued to publish, as I said, the book and the writing about it. You understand? But what they say, the quantum coherence allows reversible sampling of the cycle. In contrast to the hopping model, which was the hop, the exciton hop, one to the other, I was in the
This wave-like motion helps avoid kinetic stuff. Protein matrix plays an active role in the kinetic transfer in a particular protein system. So this paper, the publisher has been taken and they have a picture with light ripples in a pond. The wave-like motion of the quantum coherence allows the effect to be spread for many states. And why does the reaction center work?
Take it up. Is because the reaction center has a different property,
different thing. Mm-hmm. So, okay. You already heard this, and the three gentlemen, Admiral, Admiral, and they were the first to make. So, if you want to understand in depth what's going on, you have to know exactly which molecule is where. They crystallize it, and I know exactly where everything is. And I don't work on this system, but I work on the system which is first started by Gian Jnu. I showed you a picture of which laboratory, and it was, resolution was not so good. And Zimbabwe in England picked it up. Resolution was also not that good. And finally, Prof. Shin in Japan. I was going to review with him. It's a very nice person, wonderful person. They had a, I don't know what the previous attempt is, but one of the two. I don't know. He knows what he's going to do that. So he did the structure of the photosystem too. This is the system of the water oxidizing water molecule. And this was 1.9, but then he was a fact for everybody. Dr. Chen, what did you do? You put too much X-ray beam and you damaged your system. And so you spent many, many years after that. Now is another paper in which he studied the whole problem of the damage by X-rays. And he's come to the conclusion that he's the best. So I'm very happy that well, there's a lot of technical issues that have to hide from it. So these are all protein molecules and manganese samples. And by the way, the species that are used are thermophilic.
So if you have to use, you have to make a crystal structure from a system that is very stable and a system that's very stable living in very high temperature.
They are very stable in their temperature. You bring in the room temperature, you can ensure. And they check. So that's why they use thermochemical process. So, the first bit, I don't know if I showed you my slide or not. So the question was, now what is the primary photochemistry? So in 1989, before all these things happened, I made a trip to Chicago. It was a chemistry, very famous now. Making artificial photosynthesis at the moment. He and I fibered to him from Colorado and in there. My thoughts and several ideas. And so we did the first measurement in primary photochemistry conversion of light energy in some sector and instead the third institution. Our first measurement to publish the cities in natural science and what we see here is the time it takes for the P680 plus the chlorophyll plus to be formed. As I said the other day, that you have a P700, let's say, and then when you oxidize it, it's a low chlorophyll system, and then a high chlorophyll at 800. P680 is also a chlorophyll, it peaks at 800. So we found that that goes with a 60%. And then we looked at the chlorophyll decay and we picked up a ratio of 60% and that matched. So we said charge separation in chlorophyll 2 takes place in
chlorophyll. As I said before, we were attacked by the quarter group and it
turned out that much more. Now it turns out that even 3 picoseconds they're not quite right for the first charge separation because there's another molecule in between which gets the electron and then passes on. Another electron. So you have P680. There's another molecule in between which gets energy faster and then it transfers to the one that we know. So the primary photochemistry is faster, but then it goes to the fighting. So now, one way. In Frank Grandella's lab in the Netherlands, look at read my thesis. She published the paper. And she showed that there are two pathways and solving all the mysteries with the various people about time. So, first, what is P680? Let us say, but you have two molecules together. So the first one at the bottom, so one, you add electron to her. So you get positive, and she gets negative. So D plus D minus. So that's according to, hit my head and not remembering. However, at the same time, there's another charge separation taking place in the same system. That's what she's saying. A slightly different system. So here, there's a chance. Did somebody else? I imagine somebody. Now here is a theophytin molecule and a chlorophyll molecule. So approximately the same time, another charge separation in parallel takes place between another chlorophyll molecule, which I didn't know about, and which we have missed. So there is a two parallel pathway that happens approximately. And then I follow. So I put the Z scheme for you, one I made in 2005, and what I want to show you is that this time, and then the second step is 200 picoseconds. Electron goes from G680 to theophytin within 1 picosecond, and from theophytin goes to the phenol within 200 picoseconds. Here, in photosynthesis 1, when we measured the first time, it was 14 picoseconds. Obviously, we did not measure precisely the first step. And now we know it is about 4.7 picoseconds, and the next one is 4,200 picoseconds. And you can get any number you want depending upon how mixed up you are in your calculation to the different equipment. So basically, within 15,200 picoseconds, you will get another one on iron containing. This is the chlorophyll, and I have discovered another chlorophyll before this. And these are kind of okay. So two pigment systems and two light reactions. And the secondary electron. So when did it take place? I told you I'm talking about in a time scale. So now I'm in a nanosecond. It is PTS scale of 9 and milliseconds, PTS scale of 3. So all these things. And I said to you later this year, I was hoping to finish this lecture up to here in the first hour. So, what we will discuss later is where the bicarbonate work on the electron acceptor side of CA. There's another cycle, which is called, also invented by Peter Mitchell, and he discovered that his two cycles is wrong, but now other people But what is the key factor? They have a cyclochrome V6 or something. So electrons are going in one way, but electrons can go like this in a tube and go through the system. And that's a little extra ATP. So we'll discuss that another day, maybe we'll see that. Now, and then the diffusion, the plastoconol, the QA is a plastoconol. It is bound. Let's say you're QA, you are bound in the space. You're QB. So QA minus, QB, QB minus, another electron comes in, another reaction comes in, could be 2 minus, it can come in, it can pass the knob, move out, and then he is sitting at the ground, moves to your place. So that's the diffusion. I mentioned on the ATP the synthesis, which we can discuss in detail how it works. All right, so this is, what is the slowest step? So we have all the science still, and the computer scientists, computer engineers, and traditional people are able to calculate and predict which will be the slowest step when. It's a very complicated thing. Professor Klaus Sultan in Nirvana, he is basically doing it in a bacterial system, and oxygen, because it requires a supercomputer, and so on and so forth. So he is not going to attach oxygen to it yet. So we're waiting. I know his people, they said, we are very busy with the oxygen system. So basically, all I want to say is for us, I mean, discussing. The details later and how we get these, but I just want to tell you that the slowest step, which if somebody wanted to change, for example, is a millisecond step, the 20 milliseconds is the slowest step when the plastic moves from here to here, and there is another millisecond step, approximately 1 millisecond for water to release. So there are two possibilities of changing the system. Improving it by increasing the faster time. And what the chemists are doing, they say, well, you guys are in nature, you move plastic. We are going to fix it. We're not going to let it move, and so then it will be fine. So we're writing a letter and giving this guy.
Nobody knows New God.
His name is Andre Lafourcroix. So we write another publication. Pierre Deliot, the discoverer of the oxygen clock that I showed you the picture last time. Pierre Deliot was a student of Wurmser, René Wurmser. And they have said some of these same things in the picture. I'm sure that you hear it.
Wurmser said oxygen comes from water. We started and said oxygen comes from CO2. So we started with the Nobel laureate.
Father was the Nobel laureate. So, but pourquoi? Simple Frenchman. There was a time when in France the women also didn't go to the pool. So Pourquoi was asked to write a book for the girls. So he wrote a book in 1787. And he said, Universelle de Dame Principe de Chimie par Monsieur de Pourquoi comme deuxième, the first one, and from the first, through the hotels, and the park. So, what did he say? He said, oxygen. So he just sees everybody. And we were just publishing a letter written in the public French piece and then to let the world know. Even Rabinovich didn't know about it. So that was a surprise to me because we need to. So that's just for fun. So now you'll see this, and we're going to do some demonstration with balloons. But just make sure you see the result. Oh, sorry, material. Here's the result I showed you before. So here's one flash of light. And then you have some light to use the balloon. So you can still see the diagram here in the light, right? So what they found, the first flash, what Pierre found, this is his wife, by the way, no oxygen, second no oxygen, third, high oxygen, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, high. So the period of four, there's a period of four in oxygen. Because that's thinking. Two molecules of water. There is for you. So what is two molecules of water? Of course you will see where it's from. So you have two oxygen atoms and two molecules of water. You have four protons. By the way, the sizes don't match the the electrons are very small, then the protons and then the and they are not arranged the way water molecules are arranged, but they are arranged the way we could arrange it today. So, one photon temperature. Oh, no, before I do that, I have to tell you. So, this is the period before. How come it goes into the third flash? It should go into the fourth flash. Oxygen should come out there. That's a cost to not in the system. He said, I understand. He, as I told you last time, he went to Paris and spent hours and hours, day and night, up in the field. He went back and started thinking in the experiment. And then he then started writing a theory. So he said, it seems the nature has invented that already you have one positive charge on the complex function. Already there. Other impact. And so when the first flash comes in, you go one step, one step. And then by the third flash, you have removed all the four electrons. So there is a, and then you have period dissociation. So we'll show you see in a minute. Then he did many experiments and changed with single flash, two flashes, so on and so forth to get the whole idea of his new way of thinking. And of course, this picture, as I told you the other day, appeared early on, the same guy, and the American Mafia, and some power from Russia and the South. It's wonderful. So now let me see. So, we will forget about interfering in the third flash. And the seventh, we say, we're going to finish the fourth flash. And you can make it do that, by the way. I can have it still. In fact, I have it still. In fourth flash, not first flash. So, one photon comes in. So it takes in an electron from something that's sitting next nearby. It's a tyrosine molecule. Tyrosine. 5Z is because tyrosine 161 and a D one token. So then that stuff, so now the water molecule is sitting here on the manganese complex, and then outward, and then this puts this electron in the YZ with a lost electron. So now you have a water molecule like that. So when the second flash comes, the same thing happens. Then you second electron is going the same route. Then the third flash. I'm assuming that we have the fourth flash. And what is happening to the proton? We didn't look at that. So the proton could be lost. And an electron is gone. Proton energy levels are set. It can be lost. It's each step. Or something else more complicated. So we shall assume. By the way, this unfortunately I'm blue up to yellow. So basically, when all these reactions four times have taken place, all the protons are in the next step.
in them, but we're left with two options. They combine and then optimize it. So normally sometimes when I do this, I have helium. You can imagine you're teaching. So let me make sure that I don't make more noise. So you get a feeling that, and there's a lot of chemistry here. So this is, so there's many schemes have been made of how this happens and what. So Bethencourt decided he's going to call it S, the component S. If the manganese is in what you say S-state, I'm not going to tell you what it is, he said. I would call it manganese, which is the major thing that's working. Even so he said the whole system actually starts with what we call the S1 state. Then with one flash of light, you go to the S2. The second flash of light, you go to S3. The third flash of light, to S4. And that immediately reacts with two molecules of water. How jumps out. So that's the piece of why the third flash. And now, let us see. So the third flash, so here's the third flash. Now, there's a fourth flash, fifth flash, sixth flash, seventh flash. So it goes on and there's a period of four. Because the system is such that it is a very stable chemically system. So this is the thing. Have a theory, and there are quantum chemists about why. I'm not going to be able to explain that. Right? But now the question of protons. As I said, are the protons being released? So the many measurements have been made. Many, many people are working on it, including Wolfgang Unger, whose name I have. So they're looking at after one flash. One, nothing comes out in the second, and the third it comes out, and then the last one was two protons. So that's behind this magic, behind this chemistry. Why does it happen? It's all due to the electrostatic charges. And people like Ari Warshall and Ruby Marcus, they worry about it and they make calculations to show why, but they need a lot of data from the biology. So that's how it is explained. And this is from my scientific method. Now, is it where it was enough? Here's a picture from Kumenaga. And the structure says the four manganese in this, what is S? What is S? Four manganese, a calcium. And four molecules of water, not two. Oh, they are still, even which water molecule is really two. All right, so the structure, Romina wrote, that the whole structure, magnesium 4 calcium 05 structure resembles a distorted chair with asymmetric Q band serving as a seat band and the isolated Mn4 and O4 serving at the back of the chair. That was 7 minutes ago. So I went to the internet, I found the distorted chair, and I said, yes, and son, you say, son, and it's and son, I got to find something else for you. Oh! You put it in the paper, okay. So it's a curtsy in the chair I chose from the internet. And who added, I added cold water to the kind of the chair, because it's cold water. I added the cold water. So the question is which water? The last tremendous number of studies going on which water? Two water, they're doing side electricity, then figure out Okay, so I don't know when I have to stop, but I'll just keep going on until I get a hand to say. What has happened now? We are now in, you know, we're going through the time. Right? Now we are in ETS scale, up to minus a millisecond, kilosecond. So in this time scale, you have a photosynthesis. You have something called state change. I'll explain to you, and not today. Then sugar and carbohydrates are formed. Hopefully, you can provide for that. Protein and fat. And there's also protection against excess light, which is and then there's a cell moment. And all the things that some of you want to know about. And this is, as you know, ADP synthesis is the ADP. We'll see more about. Now, the thing is, how do we know that it's helpful? There are many papers. How do we know the membrane production? So, then appears you saw the experiment of Jagendorf, in which he put the chloroplast at pH 4, and then he put the pH 8, and then ready to pee. Whatever delta pH making it clear. Membrane potential work was done by Gian Jnu, and he simply did an experiment measuring the membrane potential. You put in a pigment there which senses the membrane potential and it changes the effect. Something was discovered long ago. So they used this, and then they put ADP and CI with and without toxin, which changes the membrane potential, and they can show the relationship, and they can show the time effect of the reaction. So these are the millisecond. They're able to look at the bottom number. So it's still slower than. So then, of course, I'm not talking about these things in detail, but telling you the time scale, because we're going from centimeters onwards. So we have developmental adaptations. Many people are interested in these kinds of things. And have questions on photosystems, biochemistry adjustments. There's climatic adaptation. Plant lives in some light and it changes, and another light it changes, and algae is happening. So all those things are biology and physiology. They do not affect the basic. And then genetic adaptation of mutants and so on. So that's another branch of biology. I will explain to you taking this if possible. And then the evolution is taking place, which is the evolution now. Obviously, the evolution is going on at a very fast, but a very slow step, very not perceptive. It's only when you are in a gigaseconds time scale. 10 to the 10 seconds, the 5 seconds. So you talk about clocks and environment and life and outer space. And so I want to end this talk by showing you some good things people are trying to do. So this is just basic. Well, I mentioned this, and I would like some of you to take these papers to give presentations, because they are the future things. Whether true or not, you know, Einstein was proved after how many years today. Whether these things will work or not, who knows, after how many years. So I'd like to appreciate that some of you will take up these papers from the magazine company or from the dark box. There's a flagship from the paper, and many others. Comparing photosynthesis and photovoltaic efficiency and recognizing the potential of improvement. Let's say goal is to linear photosynthesis for 1. So, goal is to engineer photosynthesis for 1 so that it can use longer wavelengths and thus more of the sunlight as photovoltaic. So the whole idea is oxygenic bacteria are absorbing. But the oxygenic photosynthesis is not absorbing. So the idea is to generate oxygen. And this is just to show simply a relationship between the blue light, you know, the rock can't do anything about it because it comes down to the red. That's just a summary of what I've been talking about. And just to emphasize to you, the absorption spectrum is related precisely to these energy levels. E equals S to lambda. We have blue light, we have blue absorption, red light, and red absorption, no absorption because of no energy field, but there is some absorption. Mm-hmm. So we relate the absorption spectrum to energy levels. Now, what is Gian Jnu doing? He was at MIT.
Billions of dollars and millions of dollars for this time. It worked or not, doesn't matter. Find out. Don't do anything.
So he said, well, this is natural photosynthesis. What are the CO2? I am going to produce the water, make a medical device, produce hydrogen. So he claims, that it is one bottle of drinking water. One bottle of drinking water. I think this bottle is bigger. One bottle of drinking water and 4 hours of sunlight, I will generate 30 kilowatt hours of electricity, enough to power an entire city. So some of you want to go to the internet, find the setup, and see.
For how long?
Pardon me?
Power an entire home for how long?
Pardon me?
Powering an entire home for how long?
No, read it, and you give me the answer. So you have to calculate, right? So I can't calculate so quickly in my head. So but first read what I'm saying. Yeah. You claim that just one bottle an hour can generate 30 kilowatts, enough to power an entire home. Yeah. Now which home? That's a good question. So he obviously has in mind some calculations in which he makes the general statement. And I even recommend send him an email. He will tell you the answer. I can also tell you the answer, but what I'm saying, I'm afraid to say something that I am not sure of. That's why I don't answer such a question. All right. So in this process, in his experiment, consists of a cobalt-based catalyst that uses solar energy to split water and produce hydrogen. Using the electric energy obtained from a 30 square meter photovoltaic array, the ferrous catalyst converts to water.
Okay, so the
process is just like photosynthesis. The plant doesn't have any oxygen. So basically, how much amount is a matter of engineering. Okay? It's not a matter of basic science that one can say. Question is, how long it takes depends on what you're going to do, what your goal is, and the calculations, the answer will depend on many of those parameters. Okay? So, what the other thing? Okay, the other people who have been in photosynthesis for ages say, we don't want this artificial photosynthesis. Why? You are using cobalt. You are using nickel. And you are using all these things. And I say the same thing, but still search it on. And you are made poison. So that's a fear of, but they are full of, they know what they're using and why they're using, they're not letting it out of the lab until So the other people decide, we are going to use algae to make hydrogen. Show me the motor in which hydrogen evolution was discovered. And Mike Seibert, Maria Ghilardi in Colorado, Dr. Melissa Berkeley, and many others. You know, and we have a book on hydrogen. And so they say, okay, we're taking the micro for the sunlight that's yellow.
and then make hydrogen. But then the Dixier was also
a few consortium about 10 people, 10 people, and then people from India working with Dixier at the moment, from many parts of India. And the good friends, we probably put together.
And they say extracting oil from algae to produce a more sustainable biofuel is one of the most powerful and exciting ways of biofuel. Algae have significant potential with a clean, renewable, and economical source. And because algae are not used as food, they are a biofuel source, but they are not completely. So, Adita thinks that we should think about one thing. And now, in Urbana, there are two major ideas that come. One, as I already mentioned, that you have a plant and greenery, very green, the soft light, and then photosynthesis cannot take place because too much light loses energy and heat it and then it will come. And so, as a lorry, it's much less light and that's not enough. And a third one. So, what they have a computer specialist who said, well, let's redesign the plant and let's put different amounts of chlorophyll and see what. So they calculated it, and using all these rate equations and student fixation rate and everything. And I mean, I can't answer it, but it's not until it's experimental proven, I think the fact is there. Well, they're working on it, and we get the answer, not so they produce this, these are this, and the media who are involved in these calculations, they have calculated there is 30% more carbon, more energy in the plant. And here is another graph. And so, depending upon the leaf number, the leaf one, because it's highlight, is no different from photosynthesis. It doesn't matter how much light you put on, it's calculated because of the enzymes, so the bits go. You can't do anything there. And this one, the leaf two, you can see the pale leaf is better. And these are all calculations by the computer simulation. So basically, these experiments are going on. The nutrients are being actually produced. They have been tested. They're being produced in Australia and soon in campaign at Banana. So I end you there, but also to just say that another technique, and I repeat these things to produce seeds that people may or may not see. In kind of bacterial gene, putting it in high plant, and hoping that will, that particular gene and culture will allow more of these seeds to be used. So, is it okay to stop? Or? Yeah. So please ask questions, but I say I have not been answering many questions. And the reason is very clear, that these are very good questions, but very intricate questions, in the sense that to answer glibly, I can say something. But in reality, it is so complex that we have to think through. So if you want to talk with me, we can sit down and you interact, and I will be very happy to discuss these things. And I am not an expert in everything. I only know very little in photosynthesis.